This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Her Darkest Secret, written by Addison Moore. Prologue. They say to commit murder is a crime against your soul, as much as it is another person's body, an everlasting burden. I say it was a relief, like lancing open my own throat just to breathe for the very first time. But one corpse led to another, and soon I left my own life to step into someone else's. I never meant for things to go so far. I never meant to leave a trail of bodies in my wake. I never meant to keep a secret so dark that it held the key to another hell entirely. I never meant to say I'm sorry. 10 months earlier. They say if you're going to hide, you should do it in plain sight. Sort of like those childish books my brother and sister were obsessed with, the Go Find series. You search in a sea of thousands of miniature cartoon-like faces, hoping to scout out some squirrely-looking man with a mustache, or in my sister's case, a pink cat with a wizard's hat. It was all fun and games back then, with Peavy and Devon seated on either side of me. Peavy is 6 years younger than me, formal name Paul Richard. Don't ask me how it evolved to Peavy. Nobody is actually certain about that. Devon is 3 years younger than him, and they're both my half-siblings according to biology, full siblings according to my heart. Hell, they are my heart. I live for them. I die for them. I'd kill for them, and did. My feet come to an abrupt stop as I steal a moment to gaze at Conrad University, in all its Gothic marble and limestone glory. Sort of an odd sight in smack dab middle of nowhere Idaho. But with enough money to back it, you could make just about any delusion happen, and I'm staring at the biggest eyesore of them all right now. Architecturally, it's breathtaking, but it's remarkably out of place in this reality. Wakefield is a small one-cow town. Conrad feels Disney-esque, something so wonderful you wish with all your heart it was true, not to mention the fact the price of admission will set you back a couple hundred paychecks. And for a drifter like me, there will never be enough of those to land me in a place like that. As it stands, I have my boss Joe to contend with at the Hideaway Cafe. He needs things I can't give him right now: driver's license, social security card. The tips of the iceberg for a place like Conrad, who will want to delve deeper into my history and fish out report cards dating back to preschool. A private school like that probably requires dental records. A couple of letters of recommendation would be a given. They would want blood. And oddly enough, I could give them that last one. It wouldn't even have to be my own. I had a body I could milk for that sanguine liquid, once upon a time. Yes, I could give them blood. It just wouldn't be mine. The fresh scent of pine fills my lungs on this heavy blue sky day as summer gives way to fall. It's a quick turnover here in this part of the state, the changing of the seasonal guard. One day it's balmy out, the next the sun is but a dream and jags of lightning spear down in every vacant field. It's as thrilling as it is terrifying to watch, let alone live through, if you're seeking shelter behind a dumpster at the Hideaway Cafe. But that's no longer my home. I take a few brazen steps closer to Conrad, still tucked several hundred yards away from the prestigious university. Gabby, my dumpster savior, invited me to sit in on a class, but I don't think I'll go. Instead, I soak in the palpable academia of it all in the nearby woods. An entire verdant world is landscaped around the school like an emerald fortress, adding to its ivy appeal. You couldn't even call it a poor man's ivy, because the cost of tuition is up there with the real deal. No. Conrad doesn't play second fiddle to anyone. It's top-notch. Nothing but the best and the brightest. Which begs the question why someone as bright as Gabby Foxworthy would open her doors to a sewer rat like me. The ever-expanding pines press in around me as I jog deeper into the woods along a well-worn dirt trail, with a smattering of pine needles to cushion the sound of my worn tennis shoes as I beat them over the ground like a heartbeat. A bright red square catches my eye near a late-blooming dogwood, and I steal the moment to head over and bury my nose in a white starry bloom. Ah! Smells like heaven. God's perfume, my mother used to call it. I remember the bush from Stratford. We had one just like it outside of our apartment. It's the only good thing from that sorry town other than my brother and sister. My mother sold us for her next hit, so she disqualified herself from the memory. I pull back and eye the small red square before pulling my sleeve over my hand and picking it up. No fingerprints. It's something you learn along the way in ex-con U. But if you want to get technical, there is nothing X about this con. Not so sure I'm a con either. I bring the leather square forward and gasp at the treasure in my hand. Oh, wallet. Oh my shit. God, let there be money in it, I whisper as I bury my left hand in my sleeve and get to work. I count out three $10 bills and balk as I slip them into my pocket. Of all the damn rich girls running around this place, I find the one with a pittance. A couple of cards sit snug in a leather pocket just behind the bills, and my adrenaline kicks in. A driver's license, a social security card, credit cards, debit card, but I don't dare add theft to my repertoire. No, thank you. Murder suits me just fine. And I have no remorse about it either. Therefore, according to Psychology Today, for the spare library card my aforementioned dumpster savior lent me, I also qualify as a textbook sociopath. Well then, I pant as I slip the license and papery social security card into my pocket. I shouldn't feel too bad about this minuscule heist. I'll simply give the goods to Joe, and when it comes back to bite me in the ass, I'll say I input the wrong information. Mix up. Bat my lashes. Show some tits. Guys like Joe don't believe a nice girl like me could be rotten to the core. Deep down, a nice girl like me doesn't believe it either. I drop the square back to its bed of pine needles and start in on my jog once again, this time with a spring in my step. $30 might as well be 30 million. This is already shaping up to be a banner day. A silver spear glows against the dark ground just a few feet ahead. Another find, no doubt. Some stupid co-ed must have lost the contents of her purse doing the walk of shame this morning. Can't complain. Her loss is my financial gain. I head over and stop abruptly with my back hunched, my right hand already lurched out, greedy to steal another treasure from the ground, but I'm frozen solid. That's no silver spear, nothing even remotely close to something I want to touch. The soft buzz of insects lights up the air as a swarm of flies dance over an open red gash. Muscles. The form of human legs, a girl's, a woman's, steals the light from the world, and all I can see is the heavy bruises, the gray lifeless limbs of somebody's daughter, their sister. I take a cautious step forward, 6 inches and no more, and then I see it. Opened eyes staring vacantly at the sky, blonde curls unsettled around her face like a bad Halloween wig. Something akin to a gas hiccups in my throat, mixed with bile, assuring me I could vomit on cue. Call someone. Dead people need help, don't they? Oh my God. Can't move. Can't breathe. A bubbling laugh comes from somewhere behind me, and I hop over a clearing of fresh dirt and onto a bed of pines before breaking for the other side of the woods, pausing momentarily only to hear a pair of shrill screams. There. Body discovered, and not by me. I shudder as I slip into a stream of co-eds walking north from campus, blending in seamlessly. I didn't step in the mud. A part of me is relieved. There are no markers that I was anywhere near another crime scene. My hand floats over the contents in my pocket. I had patted myself on the back too soon. I may not have been responsible for that particular dead body, but we would forever remain inextricably connected. Present day. Charlie. It happened finally. Death had found me in my bed. In a fit of agony, I wrestled with a sudden tightness in my chest, excruciating and violent. But others will assume I've gone peacefully in my sleep. Oh hell, let them think it. I've lived out my 96 years on the planet with bliss, with trials and triumphs, and now my soul rises to the ceiling, floating as effortless as a helium balloon as I drift through the rafters into the night sky, already milky with the promise of morning. The sky recedes like a scroll, and a bevy of familiar faces surrounds me as I soar ever higher. Here I am on parade for all my former acquaintances to see. Oh my, there's Randall. My husband of 65 years. My mother and the father I never knew, already with their arms extended. Their mouths cheering, but I can't hear them. Instead, music fills the air. My God, is that ABBA? The winner takes it all vibrates through my being, beautiful and melodic as I fly higher, ever so higher to this brilliant destiny. A shining being, so full of light and love, offers me an easy smile, his enormous hand, and I take it. And just like that, I wake with a jolt, sitting up in my bed as if ready to lurch right out of it. The old radio alarm Gabby gifted me is blaring the song that haunted my dreams, and I slap it silly until the room is bone quiet. Randall. What the hell kind of name is Randall? I shower and dress and meet up with my roommate in the kitchen, with her fingers knotted up in her wild curls as she hovers over her laptop. Geez, Gabby groans into her coffee, her eyes never leaving the glowing screen. A cop was killed in Hunter last night after responding to a domestic dispute. It truly is the most dangerous job in the world. I grunt as I pull out the creamer from the fridge because, ultimately, I know where this is heading. I'm pretty sure those guys that install cell towers, some lumber, and or steel workers might disagree with you on that. Nevertheless, she lifts her coffee my way, and those glowing mossy green eyes of hers twinkle. Gabby is beautiful, with her chestnut-colored hair and vibrant backlit eyes. She could easily be a model, and she has been in one of her many incarnations. At 22, she's already had more career changes than your average 40-year-old. That's what happens when your grandfather is the hotel god who introduced the country to affordable overnight stays 6 decades ago. And now the entire planet is pimpled with enough Foxworthy inns to put a dent in the homeless population if he wanted. But he's dead, and dead people often don't get a vote, unless parties represented by a donkey or an elephant are involved. I'm not exactly a fan of politics. My eyes wander to that hotspot in my bedroom and frown. I'm not a fan of the dead at the moment, either. So Jackson's cousin Theo is like totally hot. She wiggles her shoulders while doing her best impression of a valley girl from the 80s. You know you can't hole up in this condo forever. All you do is work and sleep. I hate to break it to you, but you're not dead yet. Well, that is the end goal, you know. Death is pretty much inescapable at this point for the both of us. I slip the K-cup into the Keurig and get my coffee brewing. Gabby's condo is immaculate, decorator finished and perfectly ready for a spread in Architectural Digest if need be. Gabby comes from money, truckloads of it. And it affords her to do anything she wishes, even taking in a street urchin like me. The day we met, I was sleeping behind a dumpster at the Hideaway Cafe, still grateful to have scored a paying gig that let me eat the leftovers off any plate I wanted, so long as I did it behind the scenes. Joe, the owner, had lost his wife in an auto accident the year before, and according to the waitresses I work with, his heart softened to the hurting world. Prior to that, he would have shot me on sight. I guess timing is everything. Lucky for me, Death and I often coordinate our plans. Gabby snaps her laptop shut as if making a statement. Okay, how about we turn down the morbidity and get back to the task at hand, getting you off your lazy single bottom and into the wild. Jackson and I are seeing a movie tonight. You can join us. And if Theo happens to show up, we can call it a double date. Come on, he's a totally nice guy. Nice guys don't thrill me. Besides, my stomach actually turned when you said double date. I schlep my coffee over to the breakfast table to join her. How about no? How about you and Jackson enjoy the movie, and I'll come home after work and enjoy the sweet oblivion that is sleep. Wow. So poetic and pathetic all at the same time. She shakes her head at me. I will never understand you, Charlie Neville. She takes a few anxious gulps from her mug before rising and snatching her backpack off the couch. I've got English lit at 9. Care to sit in? Every now and again, Gabby has let me crash a class with her. She says her professors don't mind a bit, and being that the Foxworthy family makes a sizable donation to the university every year like tax-deductible clockwork, she doesn't mind breaking a few rules a bit either. Gabby is a graduate student working toward her MBA in hopes to run the family hotel empire one day, and I'm sure she will. I'm also sure she and Jackson will tie the knot soon. Her obsession with all things bridal has hit a crescendo over the last few months. And soon thereafter, I'm sure she'll start popping out adorable babies with matching mossy green eyes that will leave the world spellbound by their beauty. The hotel industry might have to wait for her to take her throne. It's a rosy outlook for her either way, and I realize that my time as a freeloader is quickly coming to an end. With lousy tips and siphoning as much as I can out of the registers, I'm still well below the poverty line. I'll most likely be homeless again come May. It's a bleak thought that immediately dampens my spirits. I'm not sure what kind of life I thought I'd end up with after, but dumpster diving and visions of homelessness weren't anywhere on the horizon. After. My life only has two markers, before and after. After promised to be so much better. It is, but not in the way I had hoped. What time is abnormal psych again? That's the one I like. An entire hour focused on how twisted and depraved the human mind can be. The professor is an odd man, handsome but too thin, and you could bet money he's hiding something dark behind that painted-on smile. It never leaves his face. Like a rash he can't get rid of. Creepy. I'd bet good money he has particular tastes in the bedroom. I've thought about taking him up on that silent offer he sent my way. Interested to learn more about me than my ass. On second thought, that's probably exactly what he's interested in learning more about. 1. Her voice hikes with glee as she hits the front door. Are you coming? Maybe next week. I'm scheduled 8 to 5. That means you're free for dinner. She bubbles with laughter as she shuts the door. I'm making it happen. Gabby would love nothing more than for me to date Theo the cop. I shake my head at the thought. I'm sure there are a number of people who would love for me to have a date with a police officer and a much longer relationship with a warden at a state-run penitentiary. A dull laugh ripples from me as I take a sip from my coffee. Can you make wishes from hell? I shower, dress, and head off to work. The only date I'll have tonight is at the public library to speak with Peavy and Devon. I made a wish from hell a little over a year ago. And I got exactly what I asked for. I managed to escape the infernal fires and sent someone else there instead. The Hideaway Cafe first caught my attention for its ironic name. It was exactly that for me for so long. Joe Morris, a heavy-set man with a lantern jaw and overall unhygienic look about him, houses an entire assembly line of dumpsters behind his restaurant, just close enough to the stucco building to hold in a minuscule amount of heat at night. It was July and the sun was still heavy, burning with summer anger as it straddled the country. If it were winter, I would have frozen in the snow. I wish I could say that's why I waited to do what I did, but that's not the case. The cauldron was getting too hot. I saw a window of opportunity and had just enough time to map out a plan. Premeditated murder could most definitely lead to life in prison. Peavy and Devon understood I had no choice but to run. The Hideaway Cafe, a squatty, dirty building with poor signage, is exactly 0.6 miles from the Steel Eagle condominium complex. And it's exactly 0.2 miles from Conrad University. Go Eagles! The entire building is overrun with co-eds and their noisy boyfriends. It's mostly populated with females, an odd segregation of the sexes, but I've noticed during my short 21 years on the planet that people have a way of doing just that. Wakefield is full of forests and neatly manicured lawns, odd in general to me since the part of the state I hail from is flat lands, dirt fields, and liquor stores. But I like the woodsy feel of it here. You can smell affluence in the air by way of the gallons of French perfume the girls at Conrad bathe in. One would assume that since the Hideaway is within walking distance of a major university, that it would feel the effects of the money pouring through this town, but no such luck. The students generally flock to the strip malls that surround the school like a brick-and-mortar fort. No offense to Joe, but the food offerings are on an entirely different level there. Gabby is vegan, and her boyfriend Jackson is doing keto. And if their eating habits are indicative at all of anyone at Conrad, then I'm betting there's not a very big demand for all-day breakfast. The all-you-can-eat pancake sign might as well read Carb Lover's Delight. The cube steak and endless omelet combination aren't exactly hitting it out of the park either. I've even heard the cooks complain about the lack of culinary diversity on the menu, but Joe is nearing his 70s, and he'll tell anyone who will listen that this is the kind of food that built this good nation. Joe is all about God and country, and a decent helping of biscuits covered in bacon grease. I think back to my time in Stratford, eating warm bologna from a cooler on most days. I have to side with Joe on this one. PV Devon and I would have lost our carbohydrate-starved minds if we could have eaten all the pancakes we wanted. But they eat well now, and so do I. Hours drag by as I force myself to run circles around the establishment. The decor itself leaves a lot to be desired, old wooden tables and chairs with a smattering of expletive-riddled etchings. The black and white terrazzo flooring gives off a dizzying effect that makes me sway on my heels after 4 hours, and the walls are painted a thick coat of avocado, the paint curling and pocked, tempting customers to chip away at it as they wait for their meals. There's a stainless counter that runs the length of the place like a long steel tongue, with a register seated over it near the front door. Joe's wife Anna had an affinity for quirky wall clocks, so every square inch of the place is covered with cats, whose eyes move back and forth, cuckoo clocks that sing and chime, and they all go off at indiscriminate times. Not one clock in the place tells the right time, and Joe suggested once it was purposeful. He never wanted anyone to clock watch while they were in here. He heard that in Vegas, they block off all natural light and don't display the hour so that gamblers will lose track of time and spend all their money. I'd hate to point it out to Joe, but in the restaurant business, he should be far more interested in turning tables than in keeping the loafers glued to the cheap seats. But then again, if the all-dayers didn't take root to the furniture the way they're prone to, the place would be empty half the time. As it stands, there are only a handful of brave new souls that give the place a chance each week. Very few ever come back. Dina and I work the floor. Dina is an older woman, late 60s, has worked at the Hideaway since she was a teenager. Her hair is spun into a beehive with the texture of cotton candy. Black with white roots. We have that in common, but you can trade blonde for her gray. She smells like a toxic combination of peppermints and Lysol, and strangely I find this comforting. Not sure what odor she's trying to mask, but if she were running on the theme of the other employees here, it's not a legal one. Never married, two cats. I see my destiny etched on the lines of her face, and I don't mind all that much. I like cats. They're aloof, and all-around content to be alone, like me. It's not until after the sun starts to go down that I'm jolted from the comfortable trance that gets me through a long shift. In walks a tall, dark, and intimidating wall of steel, robed in the most frightening shade of navy. The shiny gold badge on the left side of his chest winks my way as if acknowledging the malfeasance I've committed. My bones seize and my muscles tighten to stone, making it impossible to move. He comes this way with me pinned behind the counter, trapped like an animal. I shoot a quick glance to Dina, who is happily chatting to an all-dayer who likes to spread her second-hand books around the table like old friends. I swallow hard as he comes my way with an affable smile. Dark hair, eyes as bright as a colorless sky, all teeth and dimples. Hell, if he weren't in uniform, my hormones would be shooting off right about now. They are, anyway. You go by Charlie. His deep voice penetrates me intimately, and for a brief moment, I feel as if I were just violated on some level. Go by? My heart drums up my throat, into my ears, as my entire body pulsates with the erratic rhythm. My mind screams run. My feet, however, remain oddly nailed to the floor. His brows furrow. I'm sorry. I just assumed. I mean, you're not wearing a name tag. He winces, and something about the action washes away the hardness of that inky uniform. A gun sits in its holster like a steel threat. My eyes bolt to that shiny gold badge once again. An oblong herringbone pattern of some kind is printed over it. I'm too far away to properly make out what the image is. And then, just as if he heard, he closes the distance between us, and I read Theost of Rose and Police Officer. The word Wakefield rounds out the rim of the badge. Theo. A flood of relief washes over me, stealing the heat from my body and replacing it with an icy chill. God, this is Gabby's setup. The totally nice guy. Jackson's cousin. Yes, that's me. A dull laugh escapes me as my flesh slaps cold from sweat. I'm Charlie. I'm going to kill Gabby. And coming from me, it's a bona fide threat. So, are you here to arrest me or just interrogate me for a while? But then you're a mind reader, so you don't need to do that, right? I mean, you knew my name, and like you so astutely pointed out, I'm not wearing a tag. Always, always remain calm in the presence of law enforcement. I've read enough true crime stories to know what lands someone in the hot seat, and silence and a serious lack of humor buy you a one-way ticket straight to the penitentiary. I loathe flirting with another human being. I loathe most human beings in general. Smothering Gabby in her sleep with that ratty-stained pillow of hers is completely on the table. He belts out a short-lived laugh, his chest bobbing up and down as if he were actually enjoying my presence, but I'm magnetized to those blue-gray eyes of his that seem to shift color. At the moment they favor steel-gray, dove-gray, pencil-gray. The dark stubble lining his cheeks makes my fingers twitch to touch it. He's handsome in a rugged way, alarmingly so. The entire female population in this greasy spoon is leaning in his direction. The men have taken notice too, but they're eyeing his gun. The girls are eyeing a far more destructive weapon though, just as prominent below that. I can't help it. When you spend a year trying not to look people in the eye, their crotch is a natural place to fall. They're seeing a movie tonight. Jackson and Gabby. His brows dip with a hint of remorse for having to stoop to ask. I hate movies. It's true. But the words bubbled out without my permission, and now I'm fearful that I'll accidentally unleash my entire life story, and so soon after I've finally harnessed it in. That makes two of us. He shoots a cool glance to the rest of the establishment. She said you get off at 5. You have time for a bite? We could head across the street if you like, or here if you want. He offers an easy smile, dotting the pleasant invitation with a happy face. Not only is Officer Theostavros comely as hell, and he is clearly a charmer, but there is a boyishness about him, a quasi-shy demeanor that makes me want to linger. Bullshit rule number 456, never leave a cop with a negative vibe about you. I'm off now and here is perfect. The next bullshit rule reads, never let him take you to a second location. We head over to the back near a window, a secluded area that makes working the loop in this place a little more tedious. My evening replacement, a middle-aged woman named Tara, waves as she walks through the door. So, I hear you're new in town, he says just as we slide into our seats. In this dim light, his eyes glow 10 times brighter. I have never seen eyes so bright, with the exception of... Oh shit. My lips are quick to betray me again. What's the matter? He glances back, his natural alert system rigged for trouble. You need to leave? Did you have somewhere to go? What? No. My heart starts in on a riot. Say yes. Take thee out. Run like hell right out of Wakefield. A dull croaking sound comes from my throat. I just realized who you are. I'm sorry about your sister. It comes out so low, it sounds like a series of hardly audible clicks. Me too. His mouth hardens. He's instantly pissed, and just as easily as the storm came, it passes, and he's back to nurturing that smile he's putting on just for me. It looks painful. I want to tell him that he doesn't need to try. It's been a year. He shakes his head just as Tara drops off a menu, just one for him, a wink for me, and a couple of waters. Thanks. He nods her way. Nice guy strikes again. You'd think I'd get used to it. But you can't. My mom and sister are in hell every day, right along with me. My stomach lurches. God, he's human. His whole family is human. For so long I've tried to compartmentalize it. I had seen the missing posters up all around town, on campus at Conrad, before Gabby rescued me from the streets like a stray. Lizzy Hartley, age 27, last seen the 7th of July 17. It had an eerie ring to it. I've memorized that flyer, her face with the dark wiry hair, pale eyes, cut features. It haunts me in my sleep. I'm so sorry. I swallow down all the lies begging to bubble from my throat. An upbeat song starts in through the speakers and brightens the mood between us. We don't need to talk about that. He shakes his head, those dark brows twisting like worms as he glances to the menu. We serve breakfast all day long, I say, sounding every bit like an advertisement. Sorry, it's sort of my spiel whenever I see anyone opening to the lunch or dinner options. It's all sort of iffy around here. Don't tell Joe I said that. I wrinkle my nose the way I've seen the co-eds do at Conrad. The only way out of this mess is to convince him that I'm so damn normal. That I'm someone he might actually think good things about when this is through. Females who commit violent crimes are more likely to be promiscuous. My God, I might have to sleep with him. Gabby is treading on thin ice and it's fracturing fast. A brief vision of Officer Stavros lying over me naked, his rock-solid body over mine, pulls me away from the table momentarily. I can almost feel the warmth of his chest, his fingers digging into my hair, giving a firm tug at the back of my neck. I can't help but scowl over at him. I bet he's too polite in bed for hair pulling. No. Gabby pegged him correctly. He is most certainly a totally nice guy. Please, may I touch your vagina? May I take off your bra now? It would be a game of mother may I in the chastest sense. Or at least I'm guessing. I'm wrong about a lot of things, but that one would surprise me. Well, I like your spiel, Charlie. He shuts the menu with a quiet hush and sets it to the edge. All you can eat pancakes for me, he says just as Tara hits the table with her pencil at the ready. Tara is rail thin, gaunt, wrinkles and veins around her eyes like a roadmap. She's a user. I could tell, before she admitted it to me. Her cheeks are severely puckered, and her skin has the requisite pocking just the way my mother's did. I'm not sure how she holds down a job, but I'm guessing the real problem is her man, her verbiage, not mine. She's harmless, mostly toothless, and overall kind. Sure thing, sugar. She nods over at me. How about you, Jem? My face flusters. When I first started working here, I needed a name, one not my own. I hesitated when Joe asked me my name, and he nodded as if he understood. He asked if I had a nickname I preferred to go by, and out it came like some Pez dispenser of truth. Jem. It's what Peavy and Devon called me back home. It's what my mother called me. Her Jem. Her oldest daughter. Her favorite little killer. She might not have said that last one out loud, but I'm guessing it might have a ring of truth to it if she knew what I did. I'm sure even from the grave I'd have her approval. Same for me, I say before leaning over the table, elbows down, my gaze fully focused on my nice guy date. I'm trying my best to send a clear signal to Tara, to boot scoot the hell away from us, before she unleashes any more tidbits about me. I made the mistake of getting high with Tara once about 6 months ago. Who knows what secrets I might have spilled at the time. She's toxic around the two of us. Us. I shake my head at the police officer seated across from me. There will never be an us. Tell me about yourself. Theo has a warm way about him, and that pained look in his smiling eyes screams I'm still grieving. I'm not ready for this. But a part of me believes he's interested. It's not ego on my part. Believe me, I would rather he not. But like most girls, I have a good radar for boys and men who seem genuinely interested. And Theo is just that, a strange combination of a boy and a man. I'm big on books. I rim my water glass with my finger, a mild flirtation that says I like you too. Please like me and not in any sexual way. I don't need that right now. Not from you. Your ties to the law have already ruined things between us. I like reading. In fact, I was headed to the library when you caught me. Holy hell, I struggle not to shove every napkin on the table into my mouth. I really do have a problem on my hands. Should I clue him in on the fact I particularly appreciate the free computers that I have access to? That the fact it enables me to communicate with my brother and sister while I'm on the wild and woolly lamb? We keep communication to a minimum, but we're getting sloppy as of late, talking 2 and 3 times a week. The incident skirts the periphery of our conversations like a rat, threatening to invade with an infestation. And now look at me. All you can eat pancakes with a cop of all things. Bullshit rule number 666, never share carbohydrates with an officer of the law. The library? That's great. He inches back, as if it were unbelievable. We can swing by after if you want. I mean, you lit up when you mentioned it. No. No, it's fine, really. No, sir. Sorry, Mr. Nice Guy, But this ends here with a saccharine bellyache and a waddle as I walk you out to your cruiser. No kiss. No second base, even though you've dropped those eyes to my cleavage twice now. Yes, I noticed. Mr. Perverted Nice Guy. How about you? Have you lived in Wakefield long? How long have you been on the force? You're Jackson's first cousin, right? Atta girl. Way to deflect. The one surefire way to get people to stop trying to invade your personal space is to turn the tables on them. People are ardent lovers of themselves. There is no better topic. Deflect, deflect, deflect. I'm originally from Redgrass, about a couple hours away. Lived in Idaho all my life. Bought a place up here a few years ago to grow a pear. His lips expand wide as if laughing at his own analogy. Jackson moved in with me after my sister disappeared, just to help keep my sanity glued together. Pretty boring, huh? Jackson's mom and mine are sisters. Big Greek family. He presses out a dry smile. I guess I've been with the force for about 5 years now, going on 6. I was about to upgrade to detective, but then Lizzy went missing, and my old partner took the position. He's got her case. I was too close to it. You know, paperwork-wise. The generalities of it would have been too much. I'm still working on it though, right along with him. He takes a deep breath. Not much to work on. It's been a cold case from the beginning. She has a different last name though. Really? My God, somebody bring this girl a muzzle. I mean, I've wondered about that. It's true. I've wanted to study up on her, but I'm afraid, so very afraid to know more than I already do. Lizzy was one of the first people to greet me when I arrived in Wakefield. That black and white flyer was lining my dreams. And then we had a far more formal meeting about 2 months later, and we've been closer than sisters ever since. I take an urgent drink from my water, as the room heats up around me unnaturally. My mouth should be kept busy at all times, in an effort to divert the truth from gushing like a geyser. He
grimaces. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.